Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For some time now, we've been looking at the message. Amen.
Amen.
We've been looking at the message that talks, that concentrates on our minds. And this, today again, we want to look at the message that is titled, A Different Mind. A Different Mind. Few weeks ago, we looked at wounded minds. Then we looked at rest assured mind. And today, we want to look at a different mind. Another title or subtitle would be Faith and Double-Mindedness. And we're taking our text from Acts chapter 3, from verse 1. Acts chapter 3 from verse 1. It says, Now Peter and John went up together into the mountain, into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, Look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus of Christ, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
They said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Verse 7. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. When I get to that point, I love to say to somebody that not only will you enjoy your testimonies, people will see your testimony.
Amen.
There's a level of testimony that you can hide, you can keep it in a corner. Amen. But I'm praying for you the testimony that even when you try to hide it, cannot be hidden.
Amen.
The Bible said people saw. People always see fruits of faith.
Yes.
And the people, all the people, I love that, all the people in my life, all the people will see what God has done.
Amen.
In your life, all the people, not some, all the people who have seen your shame,
Amen.
Who have seen your downside, they will
Amen.
See your upside, they will see the glory of God in your
Amen.
Life. Verse 10 says, And they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. We see three stages in this story of this man. There was a stage of before faith. There was a stage when he was developing faith, and there was a stage when the result of faith came. A lot of times people would do makeup, they show before and they do after. When those who are watching their weight, they do before they lost the weight. Most times they don't show us the process in between, but they show us the after. So in the same way we see before faith, we see this man, the Bible says, he was lame from the mother's womb. And all his life, which was already over 40, he was carried by helpers. He never could help himself move around. He had to rely on people. I don't know, I'm trying to get a message across, but prophecies keep coming in between. Let me be open. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Somebody has been carried all his life. You have been, everything you've ever attained is because some people help you. Deliverance has come.
Amen.
Now things will happen that your helpers will be wondering, how did it happen?
Amen.
Because God is coming through for you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He was always carried by helpers. They were used to it. He too was used to that. So he lay down in helplessness to fend for himself. There's only so far people can help you. Even though they helped him, they could only help to carry him to the gate of the temple. Probably some of them went inside the temple and God blessed and came and carried him away and all of that. Or maybe they just dropped him and go their own ways. But after they dropped him at the beautiful gate, called Beautiful, the gate of the temple, he has to fend for himself. He had to ask alms. He had to beg to make a living. He had to ask alms from these people who are already conversant with the supernatural. Because I believe people would not go to that temple that regularly unless something is happening in their lives that is different. That is because a temple is a place to meet with the supernatural. A temple is a place to meet with the divine. To meet with something that is above what happens normally. So if we go to temples or churches or a place of worship and the life remains the same or it diminishes, then that is not a good temple to go to. So these people who carried him, they are people who are conversant with the natural, with the supernatural. Otherwise, they won't be going to that temple. Now, sometimes I get a little bit critical. I get critical. Many church services have become entertainments right now. But the church, the temple, shouldn't be a place for entertainment. Even though also it cannot be a dull, boring place where people are not, where people sleep off, where people are not excited. The word of God excites. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
The word of God does what? It excites. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
All right, let's keep going. So, these are people who are used to... Okay, so I was talking about the fact that a lot of places have become entertainment center, and the difference in what the church should be is that the church should be where people meet with divinity, not just to excite their senses, not just to make them happy for that moment. You know, a lot of people go to places, they jump up, but once they get back home, their misery is back on them. Their pains are back. Their disappointments are back. So that's why some people only go to church just to get that temporary relief. But a church or a temple should be a place where people get divinity come on their humanity, and when they get back home, what they got from the temples, it stays with them. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So these people bypassed. This man sat at the gate of the gate called Beautiful, the gate of the temple. Daily, he was being bypassed by those who make progress beyond his own standpoint. Once he's dropped at that place, he can't go anywhere. So others move around, but he was limited. And also, he begged. So people who are moving about, who are making some level of progress, they only drop little out of the much which they get from outpouring results and blessings of the inner temple. You know, it was surviving on pity. For as long as we begin to beg people, they will never give you their all. The best anybody can give you is a percentage of what they have. Hallelujah. At least normal, natural people. They give you just a little bit. So he was used to getting just those little drops. So this was the situation this man was in before faith came. And then suddenly Peter and John approached that gate on this particular day. And then this man was opportune to meet with a new relationship of faithful people. A relationship with faithful people. Peter and John were full of faith. And then these are ambassadors, people who are full of faith in God, are ambassadors of heaven. They are agents of the kingdom of God. So this day, because something was about to happen different in his life, he met with a relationship. All through this time we've been talking about faith. If you check the messages, we always talked about relationship. There cannot be a walking faith without some relationship involved. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But that's not the message right now. So this man came in contact with the right faithful relationship, who are agents of the kingdom of God, ambassadors of heaven. And then these people did something which is the crux or the focal point of why I'm using this scripture. They asked that he should look on them. In other words, change your perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Change your mind. And that's why we're looking at the topic, a different mind. He definitely was looking at them in a certain way before asking for something. But they told him, change that look. Change what you're saying. Something new is about to happen.
Hallelujah.
I want to show you a different side of life. Something you've not seen before. So unless you are ready to have a shift of attention, or a shift of focus, or a shift in your thoughts, the person who does the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result without doing something new, is called crazy. That is madness. You keep repeating the same step, you're not breaking new ground, you're not coming out of your circle, and you expect a new thing to happen. And unfortunately, a lot of people go to, I'm sorry when I talk like this, but it's just a pure truth. They go to certain places, over and over, place of worship, and they keep doing the same thing, and nothing new is happening, but they keep continuing. Hallelujah. There should be a different mind, a shift. So they requested his attention because they needed his mind to be stable. To be stable. You cannot impact anybody without a stable mind. Anybody whose mind shifts cannot be impacted. So the first thing they did was to ask him, look on us. And they shifted his mind from gold and silver. After he concentrated, they said, yeah, we know you are used to gold and silver, but silver and gold we don't have. Silver and gold is another name for money. We know all you want is just some more money, but that's not what we brought. So shift your thinking. In a little while, we will see how the children of Israel, having a different mind, survived in a climate of famine, even in a land that is not their own. They were living with the Egyptians in Genesis 47. We'll get there soon. In Genesis chapter 47, there was famine in Egypt. And Israel started out as slaves in Egypt. But now one of them, Joseph, he was already in power, helping the president, so to say. And then somewhere along the line, there was famine. But while there was famine, the servant of God, Joseph, was keeping, he kept collecting all the money. Money was no longer useful. And when they couldn't purchase anything with money, they brought their cattle, they brought their land, and Joseph was getting all of that. When the Egyptians were begging Joseph for survival, the children of Israel were in the same country, but in a different territory, and they were increasing daily. We will see that in a while. They were increasing, they were prospering, everything was okay for them.
Mm-hmm.
Why was that happening for the children of Israel? Because they had a different mind. A mind that is tuned to how God works things out. But the Egyptians didn't have that covenant relationship. They couldn't download what heaven had to offer. The children of Israel, thus, they were doing things part time based on how heaven or how God wanted them to take step per time. But like I said, we'll get there. They had to change the mindset of this man. They said, silver and gold we don't have. We know that's what you... So I believe that will take a little while for him to adjust his thinking. Now, okay, so what else do you have if you don't have silver and gold? They shifted his mind from the mundane to the divine, from the natural to the supernatural. They invoked the name of Jesus Christ. They said, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Somebody said, talk is cheap. And truly, talk is cheap. The Bible says, I think in first in the book of Corinthians, I think chapter 4, verse 20 or so, it says the kingdom of God is not in words, but in power. So it's talk is cheap. You could just say rise up and walk. But if nothing happened, that means there's no power. And unfortunately, we're in days where we exert so much energy talking many words, powerless words. So they invoked the name of Jesus. They said, rise up and work. I want to believe that that wasn't, I mean, of course, it took time for the man to stretch his hand to pull him up. Even if that is 5 seconds, it was time enough for this man to decide, am I going to accept that kind of new doctrine? Mm-hmm. Am I going to accept that kind of statement? Mm-hmm. Am I going to be put on the spot for display because of my situation and circumstance? He had enough room to think that. And if he didn't want it, he would have said, hey, leave my hand alone. And probably this story would have been written in a different way, mm-hmm. if it was written at all. But he took the hand that was stretched to him. When I get to this point, I want to come back to relationships. It's one of the messages I love to look at, but most times I don't get to look at it deeply enough. For that man to rise from the place that he was to the next place, somebody has to stretch hand to pull him. And a lot of people are refusing the outstretched hand that wants to pull them into the place of destiny. That want to pull them from their past into their present and into the future that they ought to enjoy. You cannot attain much in life without some good, faithful, working relationships. Godly relationships. So they pulled him up. Said, rise up and work. And he took the instruction. They gave him instruction of faith. Faith comes by hearing.
Yes.
And hearing the word of God.
Yes.
Society is tailoring our mindset because of what we hear on TV, because of the movies that we watch, because of the negative reports that are overwhelming, and so we move more in fear than in faith. Mm-hmm. So anybody who will get the result of faith must be ready to have a different mind, and it's simply a mind that is full of faith. A mind that is full of the right words. That's why men need to separate time to hear the word of God. These are days nobody wants to. I'm reading scriptures now. Some people don't. They don't. Like I said, it's more just entertain us and let's go home. So many services, people just pick one verse and begin to whine that verse over and over. And people, let me leave that alone. Just whine one verse. When will the church ever teach the people the word of God? If we can't read a chapter of the Bible in church in one day, then when will we do it? And then we have church like 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, if we just speak one verse, and the people come with, they have half-baked faith. Faith that is just dependent on that little insight you gave them, and they run to town in the wisdom of the man who gave them the faith, not in the wisdom of the word of God, or God himself. So they gave him instructions of faith. Faith is going to place a demand on any one of us. Faith is action plus what you believe. So you must believe first in your mind. You must accept first in your mind. And when you believe in your mind, you take steps towards what you believe. That is faith. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They gave him instructions of faith. Instructions of faith that demand for the impossible to become possible. They extended heaven's hand, heaven's outstretched hand to lift him. I stretch my hands to somebody who is hearing me right now.
Amen.
That you are pulled out of your state of rejection. Amen. You are pulled out of your state of disease.
Amen.
You are pulled out of your state where your mind is confused. You are pulled into the place where your mind is stable. You are pulled into the place of your wealth.
Yes.
You are pulled into the state of your well-being.
Yes.
You are pulled into the place of your promotion.
Amen. Lord.
Thank God he did not refuse the offer of faith. Today you teach all this talking I've been doing. Some people, that's too much talking. Just pray for me and let me go. God wants each and every child of his to walk by faith with him. It doesn't matter whether we are 7 billion people or 6 billion people on earth. God is able and capable to relate with each one of the 7 billion.
Yes.
You don't need an intermediary to go to God. If you are born again, if you accept Jesus in your life, Jesus is sufficient to you.
Yes,
we must not forsake the assembling of ourselves together in a place of worship like we're doing, or in people mentoring us, in people coaching us, but no man has the right to become God in your life. Or take the place of God. That except you see Baba, Baba is what we call something. Except you see that Baba, your life cannot have meaning. That is your God. And that's not what God wants. This man did not refuse the offer of faith. I just want to speak to somebody. Don't refuse this offer of faith. Let your mind be renewed to faith. Hear the word of God. Let the word of God be deposited in your mind and in your heart. And work with the truth that you know in your mind. So we've seen the before of faith, and now we are just in the process of the moment when it was developing faith, and then after faith. Hallelujah.
Amen.
After faith, his feet and ankle bones receive divine strength. Don't forget, this man was helped to come to that gate. He most likely was carried. He wasn't dragged on the floor. So he has been lifted before now. But because now he has the right kind of relationship, he has the right kind of people around him who are people of faith, who are drawing, they are drawing faith. They are drawing him by hand, a straight hand of faith. Something new happened.
Yes.
And I love what happened. After he was pulled up, that was somebody joining their faith with ease to get him up. That's where some people will sit and say, ah, thank you for getting me up. This man took over from that moment. He began, the Bible says he first of all walked, and then he leaped and he jumped. That means initially his faith was held to a point, but because he has a different thinking now, he knows that now you have helped me, it's time for me to exercise myself also in faith. I've not done the walking like this before. Let me see how it will work. Because the God that did that one will take me the next level. And after walking, he leaped. And after leaping, he jumped. Hallelujah. He exercised his newfound faith by walking. He moved forward for the first time from the temple door and entered into the temple as he has never done. He walked, he leaped, he praised God among those who once saw his shame. The biggest challenge of faith today is the challenge of you don't want eyes, people don't want eyes of others to be on them. Let them not know that I'm different. Let me just be part of the crowd. But whether you like it or not, the shame is already like this man. Whether he wanted to be separate, they already knew his shame.
Yes.
It doesn't matter how well we dress, how nice we make up, how we drive some heavy cars. People know your shame already. So the spotlight is already on you. Yes. So why not take it to the next level and let it be now the spotlight of you are acting by faith. Hallelujah.
Amen.
One time God spoke to me. I didn't understand that too well then, but it helped me, and I've been able to run ministry better. God told me, we used to have one player in Nigeria, Okocha. I don't think he's still playing for the national team. I think he should have retired now. And God showed me a picture of Okocha, and he said, do you know, Okocha is one man, I'm sorry, I'm just using that name. He could be any other name of a footballer. He's just one man who wants to live his life in one corner and all of that. But there comes a time that he must appear in the stadium,
yes,
because that is the stage of play. And now, as an individual, when the ball is coming to him, he needs to be aware that all eyes are on him.
Yes.
So how he handled the ball in that moment, every eye is watching. And if he handles it well, every eye is watching.
Yes.
If he doesn't handle it well, every eye is watching. So God gave me that different mindset to let me know I'm also on my own stage of play. So play well.
Amen.
Don't just wait and think, well, I'm on my own. Who cares? You're already being watched.
Yes.
Play well.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this man had been the signature of eyes. The people will walk past as if they don't know. Or they don't know your story. They know.
Mm.
They're just not talking about it.
Mm.
So he now moved into the temple. I don't know what the law used to be. Maybe a lame person was not permitted in the temple or something. I don't know. But now he went to meet with those that used to be above him. Those who used to go forward that he couldn't go into that same level. He went to meet with them.
Yes.
Somebody is getting out of isolation.
Amen.
Into the right eminent relationship.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Amen.
It used to be a reason for people's pity. Now it became a reason for people's party.
Mm.
They celebrate with him.
Mm.
Some hate his God. Some never wished he would rise from that place. But when God does something new in your life, even those who hate you will have to attend your party.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
They don't like your God. They don't like how it happened. But so that anybody, people will not say, are you not going for the party of that man God has just blessed? I say, I'm going. Even your enemy will celebrate you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus,
amen.
I don't know who is hearing me.
Amen.
Those who hate you right now, they will come to celebrate
amen.
You. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He was not the only one releasing the outcome of faith. People saw his testimony. That's what I said earlier. There's a level of testimony that you are just enjoying it in your own corner.
That you can't hide.
There's another level, even if you hide it, people know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the level somebody is getting into.
Amen.
He got blessed beyond secrecy.
Amen.
I don't know who is hearing me. I am blessed beyond secrecy.
Secrecy.
I am blessed beyond secrecy. The testimony of God in my life is evident. The answer that God gives to my prayer is evident to all.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Like we said in the last message, faith does not request that you lose your mind. Because this man, they said, look on us. It's just a shift. You are looking this way, but look this way now. You perceive life like that before, now perceive it this way. That is what faith is all about. Somebody think faith is, oh, I don't have control. However it goes, fine, I just believe. Mm-mm. Faith involves your mind. Hallelujah. Faith requests that you add divinity to your humanity. I said faith requests that you add divinity to your humanity. Faith invokes the unspeakable supernatural over the understood natural. That's what faith is. And we looked in Isaiah 26 from verse 2 to 4. And I just want to look at that quickly because it's a scripture that says we should stay our mind on him. He said, open ye the gates that the righteous nation which keeps the truth may enter in. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusted in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever. For in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. There are gates that keep you from... can you imagine? I didn't even look at it that way until right now. This man was sitting at the gates.
Yes.
Of a place called Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
But he wasn't enjoying beauty in his life.
Wow.
A gate was standing between his present and the future.
Mm.
And suddenly God brought divine men of faith to open that gate for him.
Amen.
Whatever barrier that is stopping the glory of God from showing in your life, I command it open in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I command every gate that barricaded you from your progress, from your promotion, to be opened in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I believe we're going to pray in a little while. I've been after the message. And one of the places God said to pray is relevant to the point I'm in right now. Peter, the apostle, we could call him the number one among equals of the apostles, he got locked up in jail in Acts chapter 12. A man who should be demonstrating the power of God was tied down.
Yes.
And the question I ask is this: why would a man who should be free to free others be chained down like a criminal because of his faith? And so there are people like that who are in faith. They are in faith, but they are chained. Just like the man, the Lazarus that Jesus called to come forth. He came forth, but still bound.
Yes.
Not free to exhibit. Not free to move his hand. Hallelujah. I break every gate. I break every padlock that is hindering your movement, that is hindering your progress, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
When Peter could not help himself and he was tied down in that jail, thank God he had a relationship going for him. Hallelujah. Bible says, and the brethren prayed ceaselessly for him. So sometimes when you are down and out, hopefully you will have some faithful people around who are standing in the gap for you. The greatest thing any one of us can enjoy in life is the right relationships. They were praying. And they were praying so fervently that even when the answer, this is the problem I have with prayerful people, pray people who love pray. Even when the answer came and the answer was knocking on the door, they refused to open the door.
They still continue to pray.
They still continue to pray. The girl that went to check the door said, Peter is at the door. They said, you are mad. You are crazy. And Peter continued to knock until they now saw. So sometimes when you, this is what I always say, the place of prayer is not just a place to place demand. Also spend a little time and say, yes, God, I've been talking to you. I want to hear from you. If they did that, heaven would have told them,
Peter is coming.
Angel is with him right now. And they'll be strengthening the angel. Oh, that angel that is at work on behalf of Peter, we strengthen you in Jesus' name. The gates are open. And then when he's at the gate, they will just say that, oh, that prayer has been answered. But people today, let's just pray. We don't want to know the mind of God. We don't want to know anything. Okay, so the gates was closed against Peter, but thank God he was released by prayers and he walked out of jail. And now the scriptures, I love the scripture. It says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace. The person who is in faith will have peace. That's why we tied to that message that we preached on that scripture. Rest assured mind. Even while you are still waiting for the fullness of the testimony, there's a peace in your heart.
Yes.
That God is at work. Somebody needs to get that rest assured mind. I want to say this again. Sometimes I used to bombard heaven with prayers and say, God, do this, God, do this. I see. God is the wicked one who is keeping my blessing in heaven. At some time, the Spirit of God said to me, your blessing is not in heaven. Don't bombard heaven. We've released it. And just like the story of Daniel in Daniel chapter 10, from the day he set his heart and mind to pray, heaven released his result. But it took 21 days before he got it physically.
Wow.
There was warfare in the heavenlies in between. So sometimes when you say, God, give me, God, do. Say that prayer twice sometimes. And well, God, you don't be wicked to withhold this from me all this while. Maybe he has released it. But there's a serpentine spirit. There's a spirit, and I think it's in the book of Job, that says he will vomit. The serpent, which is the devil, that deceived Adam and Eve at the beginning, that is also mentioned in the book of Revelation. He is still at work. The Bible calls him, he said he has come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So we need to direct our prayers away from God sometimes and direct it at the thief. Say, my friend, release my good. You false spirit that is at work against my relationship, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. You powers that always cause my business to fail, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. You power that causes people to just hate me without reason, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. That thing that makes everything I try to do to abort, I rebuke it. We need to take, that is why it says we should contend with the enemy at the gates. But we are busy contending with God over what he has released to our lives. But the ones who know when God has released unto them will have their minds in perfect peace. Let's just look quickly at the example I mentioned earlier. In Genesis chapter 47, let me quickly read 11 to 15. Like I said, many people don't like to read so much, but we can't know faith, we can't know the word, except we come to church like this and we read the Bible. Let's get friendly with the Bible. That's a manual for living, manual for life. And Joseph placed his father and his brethren and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land. I know that one is, I wish I could prophesy in that area, but there's enough prophecy in town about prosperity, so I'm going to hold that in. Because once I say you will enjoy the best in the land, oh, amen, yeah, you will enjoy the best of the land anyway. Hallelujah. Because God wants his people to have the best of the land. So he put them in the best of the land, in the land of Ramesses, as Pharaoh had commanded, verse 12. And Joseph nourished his father and his brethren and all his father's household with bread according to their families. Verse 13, and there was no bread in all the land, for the famine was very sore, so that the land of Egypt and all the land of Canaan fainted by reason of the famine. Can you imagine? In the same place where the people of God were enjoying prosperity, others were fainting for famine. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan for the corn which they bought, and Joseph brought the money into Pharaoh's house. Let's look at that closely. Verse 15. I want us to read that place where it says money failed. Verse 15. And when money failed in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came unto who?
Joseph. Joseph.
Who is Joseph, by the way? A man who survived many trials, who did not deny his faith. He went through the pit. He went through the prison, I think more than once.
Yes.
He went through rejection by family members.
Mm-hmm.
He went through, is it deception, betrayal by the wife of the boss?
Yes.
He went through betrayal by somebody he had helped in the prison. When you get there, remember me to bring me out. The man didn't even try. But he's stood on God, and in the land where others are busy compromising, he was rising over every, I wish we will get there, I hope we get there soon. Same thing happened to, we read the story of Meshach, Abednego, Shadrach. I'll show you soon, I hope I get there. After all of their temptation, all of that trial, the Bible says the same king who tried them promoted them. So for every patience of faith, there's a promotion at the end.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when the opposition, when the enemy, when people keep suppressing you, pushing you down, when circumstances keep pushing you down, and God allows it, be careful not to run out of the prison.
Mm.
Because God is perfecting something in your life.
Promotion.
Be careful not to run out of your pit experience, because God is working something out. Be careful not to run from the fiery furnace, even though it's so real, it's so massive, it's so intimidating. But God is working something out. For everyone who will have a mind of faith, you must undergo some issues.
Yes.
You must undergo some experience. You must undergo some adverse circumstances. Every major minister that God used in the Bible had to go through the wilderness experience. No matter how much God loved them. From Abram, I hope I got it this time, not Adam. Abram, Hallelujah. From Abraham, he went through wilderness places. Moses went through wilderness places. Elijah went through wilderness experience. Jesus went through wilderness experience. So this is the problem. I think this is one of the major critical problems today. You don't want to be persecuted for what you believe in. No, you can't get a promotion at the end of that. For what you believe in, somebody is going to stand against you. Forces are going to rise, and you have to survive. You have to stick through that moment. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So we see in this account, I don't have time, that's a message on its own. It's a place I love to preach from. Everybody in town, it's like an immigrant coming into a country, and the natives or the indigenous are not surviving their environment, and an immigrant, somebody who came from outside, is the one enjoying the fruit of the land. That is what the children of Israel were doing. Let me jump in that a little bit. There's something about the children of Israel. I was trying, when this came to my mind, it was quite late to do a little bit of research. Many nations, so I don't have this for a fact. Many nations, America is owing trillions of dollars. Many nations are in debt. Greece, nations are almost collapsing in Europe because of debt. I've not heard about Israel, natural Israel, being in any debt. I have not heard it. In every nation you find them, they are living well. They are, in fact, they are the one possessing the land. Up till today. And that is the old covenant still working for the natural Israel. So God is looking for a people who will covenant with him, who will be faithful towards him, so that they can be. I need to read the scripture before I jump. I wanted to jump, but I'm close to where I'm going. Because he's looking for a set of people that he called priests. This is where the message has been corrupted today. God wants us to get born again so that we can be a separate or a different kind of people to him. But today you don't know who is born again, who is not. Everything is muddled up. Because the born again is living like the world. The world is even living better than born again. Pastor, did you say that? That's it. That is what we see. And it's not today that it started. I think it started in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, if I'm correct. Or is it chapter 7? Paul said, he had spoken glowingly well about these people, that they are very spiritual people. But in chapter, I think 1 Corinthians chapter 5, if somebody will help me confirm that, I don't want to be distracted to go there. You know, he said, but now I see fornication among you that I've not even seen among the Gentiles. So today, the people, I'm correct. Okay, 1 Corinthians 5:1. It is reported commonly that you have a kind of fornication among you. Can you read it on?
As such fornication. As it's not so much as named among the Gentiles.
As it's not so much named even among the Gentiles. Thank you, sir. That's just good. Hallelujah. Amen. So we see iniquity in the church, that even the world is envying that iniquity. Because the worldly people, normally that is their own, is to drink iniquity and sin. But the church has so embraced iniquity and sin today that even the world is saying, these church people are doing it better than us. Terrible. Let's get back on course. God brought the Israelites into Egypt, and right in Egypt, when the natives were struggling, the children of Israel were doing well. Why? Because they moved themselves into a location that their own culture, their own covenant relationship, what God has stipulated, so that they can live according to what God has stipulated. They live within the premises where that can work. And for that reason, the presence and the power of God, the favor of God was working where they were. And you know why that happens? It's because God is always looking for his children to show himself mighty on their behalf. If only they will have a different mind, a different way of looking at things, a mind of faith. Hallelujah. So in Genesis 26, let's 47 verse 26. It says, and Joseph made it a law over the land of Egypt unto this day, that Pharaoh should have the fifth part, except the land of the priests only, which became not Pharaoh's. Now, I didn't read in between because that's not the issue. When money had failed them and they gave their cattle, they gave their land, after a while, Joseph kept taking all the money and there was no money. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are living, it's money that dictates their heartbeats. And that's why Peter and John told that man, we are not talking about gold and silver here. Mm-hmm. The mindset of heaven is not a mindset that is primarily moved by money. Meanwhile, let us know that the silver and gold belongs to God.
Yes.
He's the one who owns all the wealth. But look at the temptation. I'm sorry, I'm going in another direction, but I'll come back soon. When one of the temptations Jesus had to endure at the early stage of his ministry was that he should bow to enjoy the glories, which meant the resources, the wealth, the beauty of the world. He does bow. And I give it to you. And it's true, because all that kingdoms of this world is in the devil's hand even till now.
Yes.
But Jesus has come to take it back, and what Jesus took back is spiritual, and through us that are born again, the joint heirs with him, we are the ones who will establish the physical reality of the fact that he owns all kingdoms.
Yes.
But he was tempted at the early stage. And Jesus knew he must suffer some things, or suffer consequences of living by faith. And the devil said, in the Bible says, in a little time, he showed him all the beauty and glory. I said, just bow, and then you have it. Meaning that all that you want to be struggling and saying you trust God for, it's available cheaply, just bow.
Mm.
Bow and enjoy it. But Jesus said, no. He went through the struggle of faith. So here we see that scripture where there was, the priests were exempted. Now look at this, land of priests. In Exodus 19:5, I just want to establish what I've said in a minute or two ago. He says, he was talking to Moses in this place. Exodus 19 verse 5. He says, now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed. And I would like to stop there, because that is what is missing today. After you have enjoyed God's miracle blessing, he still wants you to obey his voice, his words. Okay, we'll get there in a moment. He says, now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my commandment, a covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. I want to put in between that all people, all other people. You will be a peculiar treasure above others. And this is the promise that God has for people of faith. If you will endure the trials of faith, he's going to show that you are a peculiar person. He's going to show that you are his own treasure. God loves to make display of his children. That's what he did to Job. Oh, can you see my child? He is full. He loves me to, like some people use that slang, love me to death.
Mm-hmm.
And truly, he loved God to death. Everything was destroyed around him, but he still said, I still love God. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. So here we see the intention of God is that every Israelite should be a peculiar treasure, a separate entity of people, that God can display his majesty in their lives. The same thing is true in 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. God was talking to the spiritual Israel now. He says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. Can you see that word priesthood? Every believer should be a priest. A holy nation, a peculiar people. Can you say peculiar? Different kind of people. Why would you be different? It's not because you want to be arrogant. Because some of us will see people who are walking by faith, say, why is his own different? Why does he want to do that? He's not of arrogance. He's just practicing a different mind that God has given to him or given to her. A different ideology. A different strategy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And then Revelations 1:6 says, and has made us kings and priests unto God. You need to be the king over a territory. You need to be the priest over over nations. You need to be priest unto God. A priest is one who is separated for God's own use, God's holy use. Now you can be an educationist, a teacher, and be separated for God's own use in that sector.
Yes.
You can be in the media, in the radio media, TV media, or internet media even, and be a peculiar one in that world. So this is not a priesthood that everybody should have a pulpit and be preaching. Your pulpit could be your desk in the office. It could be the cafeteria where you work, and your life, it becomes a life that is displaying the majesty of God, that people say, ah, you're a different kind of person in this setting. You say, yes, because I'm a person of faith. God is at work in my life. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Oh. I said that today's Israel has no debt, as far as I know. If they do have any debt, I am not aware. I know they own many corporations in America. They enjoy the best of God's good. I mean, they own most businesses. And they are not such a huge nation like my country, that we have 150 million. They are just a small nation, but the whole world, everything about the whole world revolves around natural Israel. I don't know if you've noticed. The troubles in Middle East, everything is about Israel. America, in my understanding, America's foreign policy is determined by their relationship with Israel. Hallelujah. So why is the believer today not trying to be unique? Because we don't want to live by God's kind of faith. You need a different mind. In Numbers 14, verse 24, God was talking about Caleb. He said, but my servant Caleb, because he has another spirit with him and have followed me fully, him will I bring into the land whereinto he went, and his seed shall possess it. Another spirit means another mind. I've said that before. One day we'll be able to break that down. Sometimes the word spirit and mind, they are close together. And that's why I think Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12 says, it takes the word of God to discern between the joint and the marrow, between the soul and the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let's look in Daniel chapter 3. I'm beginning to round up. Okay? From verse 29. Therefore I make a decree that after they have gone through the fiery furnace experience and all that. Verse 29. Therefore the king said, I make a decree that every people, every nation and language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Now, I don't want to go back to show you where he said, before I throw them in the fire furnace, let me see the God that will deliver you.
Mm-hmm.
He made that statement.
Yes,
you
need it.
Let me see the God that will deliver you from my hand. And now, after these people endured the trial of their faith, the same man, he saw God, because God, oh my goodness, I've not seen that like that before. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because he made that utterance, let me see the God that will deliver you from my hand. And then God allowed that they were thrown into the fire,
mm-hmm,
only for God to show himself. You didn't get that. He said, let me see the God. And God came to show himself.
Mm-hmm.
Because there were three that were thrown. They had the same man said, we threw three, but I can see one that is like the Son of the Almighty God.
Wow.
Even people who are not Christians or in the house of God, they understand spiritual matter.
Yes.
How did he come about with the revelation of Jesus? Jesus came to be the form.
Mm-hmm.
I love God.
Mm-hmm.
He has a good sense of humor.
Yes.
So you are saying, the God of these three guys, you are saying you want to say, okay, and throw them in the fire.
Yeah.
And then I'll show myself. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
I don't know if somebody's hearing me.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So what you are going through as a trial of your faith, God is saying to the circumstance and those who are speaking ill about you, that don't worry, you are trying to see me in his life, okay, and you will see me. I will show up at the end of the day.